Have you ever looked at some of your photos and thought to yourself, I really like the objects in the photo, but that sky is just so dull and miserable? Well, that's all about to change, as I'm going to show you how to keep the good objects and upgrade the bad sky. So let's get right into it. First, let's add your photo to the timeline. Make sure you're on the edit page by selecting list tab from the bottom and then simply press Command plus I on a Mac or Control plus I on a PC. Locate and add your photo into the media pool, and from there, simply drag it onto video track 1 of your timeline. Next, we're going to want to come into the color page by selecting list circular icon at the bottom of DaVinci, and you'll see a different looking setup now. From here, click on the effects tab at the top right, and under library in the search field, we're just going to type sky, and the sky replacement tool will show up. If you look to the left, you'll see this small box with a red outline, and this is called a node. You can have lots of nodes on your workspace, and they're mainly used for color correction and applying certain effects to your project. For example, the sky replacement effect tool we'll be using today. I'll be making a separate video all about nodes and how to use them effectively, but for now, there are plenty of other videos out there on YouTube if you need to find out sooner. Let's click and drag the sky replacement effect onto the node, and then we're going to come down to list toolbar and select the magic erase tool just here. List tool will help us to separate our current dull sky from the foreground, as we need to create a masked area for the sky, which will allow us to only control the sky and not the foreground at the same time. To do this, make sure that the tool with the plus icon beside it is selected rather than the one with the minus symbol beside it before we start. From here, come up to the sky in your photo and click and drag, highlighting the sky area. Just a word of note, this effect won't work too well with backgrounds and foregrounds that contain similar colours, especially photos with lakes or oceans in them, as they reflect the same colours of the sky and the magic mask tool finds it difficult to separate these apart. So it's best to make sure there's a good divide between your subject and the sky to get the best results. When you click and drag to highlight the sky, it doesn't need to be 100% accurate, as you can see here, but as long as you trace the general area of the sky, it should mask off most of it pretty well first time round. If you notice that the mask tool has cut off some of the area it shouldn't have, all you need to do is select the minus tool this time, and then zoom into your photo to make it easier, followed by click and dragging over the area you want to bring back, and it will appear again in your photo. Now that the sky is masked out and we're happy to move on, it's time to actually start adjusting the sky effect itself. To do this, come up to the top right of the screen and make sure you're now in the Settings tab within Effects, and you'll see the sky replacement effect with all the subsections that you can adjust underneath it. If you notice all the subsections are grayed out and you aren't able to select them, make sure that the effect is turned on by clicking List toggle button, which will appear red when activated. Now, this effect gives you a heap of customization. However, personally, I only ever use two of the subsections, the first being sky mask adjustments and the second being artificial sky. If we open up the sky mask adjustments subsection first, the tool I adjust here is the refine slider. This basically lets us soften the edges around your subject, which was separated from the sky itself. In my case, this is the edges around the buildings, which just helps the foreground to blend in better with the sky in the background, helping to create a more realistic outcome. Then, if we come out of that subsection and now click into the artificial sky subsection, this is where the magic happens. First in the list, we have sky opacity, and this is where we can adjust how dull or bright the sky appears in the background, as you can see here. I think I like it around here for this example, but you can try it for yourself and see which suits your own photo the best. Under that, you have two options for sky color and horizon color, which can both be changed by selecting the color box and choosing a new shade, followed by clicking OK so that it can take effect. If you wish, you can also use the color picker tool to the right of the color boxes and then click anywhere on your photo or screen to adjust the sky or horizon to that particular shade. Pretty cool. We then have a few options for the horizon itself. The first one adjusts the softness of the horizon. If I move the slider all the way to the left, as you can see, it's almost half sky, half horizon, which is way too harsh and doesn't look realistic. So I'll move this more to the right a touch to maybe around here, which I'm happy with and think looks well. Now let's look at horizon height, which as you can see, if I bring the slider to the right, it takes over the whole sky, which again doesn't look great. So around the middle is about right for me in this case.
Horizon Angle does exactly what it says and lets you change the angle of the horizon. If I bring the slider over to the left or right, as you can see, this is quite extreme. Personally, I like to keep it quite level along the bottom, like so. Coming down to cloud opacity, and this lets us adjust how much of the clouds actually stand out. If you bring the slider to the left, the clouds will be less visible and look quite dull. And if you drag the slider to the right, as you can see, it's almost too extreme. So I'm happy with a balance somewhere in between, like this. You can change the cloud color as well. So if you're doing any graphic design or art projects and need to spice it up a bit maybe, you could pick a crazy non-cloud color and get creative with it, like this red for example. However, I'd like to make this photo more realistic, so I'll leave it white in this example. Coming down to cloud scale, and this adjusts how much clouds actually appear in your sky. If we slide it all the way to the left, as you can see, it contains lots of smaller clouds, and all the way to the right, very few. So it's just about finding a balance that works well for us all. I like it about here. We can also change the cloud shape, and this almost adjusts how thin or thick the clouds look. Sliding all the way to the left, and it gives us almost a wide angle lens look to the clouds, and they look a lot fuller. If you slide it all the way to the right, it looks very thin and stretched, which isn't what I'm trying to go for at all, so I'll set it about here myself. Adjusting the cloud tilt almost acts like a zoom tool on your clouds. Sliding it to the left and the clouds zoom in, and to the right and they zoom out again. I think I'll set it about here. Cloud detail lets us choose how sharp the clouds appear. Bringing the slider all the way to the left and it looks very flat and smooth with no detail at all. And all the way to the right and it's super sharp and too detailed in my eyes, as there's no softness that you can see when you look at clouds. I like this setting in and around here. Now we come to cloud fill, and say it's a nice sunny day with mainly blue skies and only a few scattered clouds. You can get this look by sliding most of the way to the left, as you can see here. And then at the opposite side, it's a very cloudy day and the sun is mainly covered. Slide it to the right to achieve this look. I like it set around here, so I'll go with that for now. When you adjust cloud contrast, it almost acts like cloud opacity, which we adjusted earlier in the video. Moving the slider to the left and the clouds appear less visible, and to the right and they become a lot brighter. I think I'll just leave this option at default for now. The last cloud section tool we have is cloud time. This will change the look of the clouds as if they were changing with the time of day, so it's a cool feature if you'd like to achieve a different look or texture to your clouds. We can just slide left or right to achieve a different outcome, which is great. Now that we've adjusted the horizon and clouds to the way we like and we're happy, we come to a new section which focuses on the hotspot.
You may be wondering what hotspots are. Basically, it's a tool that can simulate a fake sun if you like, shining through the clouds that we created in the previous steps. It's a pretty cool feature, however, if you don't want to add the sun into your photo, then you can just skip this next step completely. However, if you do want to add the sun in, then let's walk through the options and brighten up your image.
First, we have hotspot brightness. If you bring the slider all the way to the left, then you'll notice there's no hotspot or sun at all. If we slowly slide it to the right, you'll start to see the hotspot appear, creating a nice sun effect. The more you slide it to the right side, the larger and brighter the hotspot will get. I personally like it about here. You can also change the color of the hotspot, just like we could with the sky color earlier. Maybe you'd like it to be more yellow or even more of an orange tint depending on the time of day or even if it's a cold or hot day outside. This could help you decide differently, so play about with it until it looks right for you.
Now, as much as we have the hotspot set up on our image, you might be thinking that's great, but you don't currently like the position of it on your sky, and it's either too big or too small. Well, with these next two options, we can fix both of these very simply.
First, we'll adjust the position. If we come to hotspot position and slide the x-axis slider to the left, we can move the sun to the left, and if we slide it to the right, you've guessed it, the sun will move to the right along that axis. I like it about here. Though I would like to bring it up a touch as well, so this is where we'll now use the y-axis slider. This time if you slide to the left, the sun will go down towards the horizon, and if you slide it to the right, the sun will go higher in the sky. I like it just about here. Now we'll adjust the actual size of the hotspot or sun if you like. Beside hotspot size, if we bring the slider to the left, the sun will disappear completely, and as you can see, if we slide it to the right, it becomes super large, taking over most of the sky, almost looking like a sunrise or sunset. If that's the look you're going for, then this could be the option for you. However, I'll set it around here. It looks good to me and I'm happy with it. The last of the hotspot settings is hotspot sharpness. I leave this option at default as it's already nicely blended in with the sky, and if you start bringing the slider to the right, then as you can see, it makes the edge of the sun look too sharp and fake in my opinion. As you can see, there are four other subsections underneath this, though with just the two subsections we've used, you can get a great result and seriously improve the overall look of your sky from the original photo, which I'm sure you can agree.
If you would like me to go through the other subsections, then just let me know and I'll create another video shortly walking you through these options.
Let's put our sky replacement effect to the test now and have a look at the before and after result by coming back into the edit page by clicking on this tab again and then coming up and clicking on the bypass button here. This turns off color grades and fusion effects. As you can see, it will now show your original photo, and then if you click the bypass button again, it will turn the effect back on. Pretty impressive how much our original photo has changed, right?
I hope you all enjoy creating your own sky in this tutorial, and if you haven't yet, why not give it a go, and let me know how your sky turned out in the comments below. Have a great day, everyone.